Hello students, today's topic is about food laws concerning hygiene and safety and implementation. The objectives of this topic are to understand about various laws, standards associated with safety, hygiene and implementation. Apart from that, we will also try to understand about various regulatory authorities and organizations dealing with food laws and associated activities. To start with, let us look into the history of food laws. Food laws were among the earliest of enactments known to man. Governments over many centuries have endeavored to provide for the safety and wholesomeness of man's food by legal provisions and appropriate action. Over the years also, rude forms of fraud such as adding worthless substances to food or extracting valuable constituents from it have been followed by sophisticated methods of adulteration more difficult to detect. But the birth of modern chemistry in early 19th century made possible the production of materials processing properties which are similar to normal foods, which when fraudulently used did not readily attract the attention of unsuspecting purchaser. Later, better analytical methods were used in food control work to detect adulterants. When scientists demonstrated that some adulterants were dangerous to health, the aroused public demanded laws that would protect both their health and prevent fraud. Food laws in one form or another, such as religious tenets or prohibitions, were inherent in all ancient civilizations and have come down to us from the early times itself. It was not until the late 19th and early 20th century, with the urbanization of societies and depopulation of rural areas, that food laws as understood today were prepared. This process was hastened by pressure that developed as the public rebelled against the generally unhygienic conditions of the period. Since the end of World War II, there have been major changes in the food industry, and this development continues till today. At the same time, our knowledge of the risks, actual and potential, has considerably increased. Reorientation and further consolidation of food laws have therefore become necessary to protect the health of the consumer from the many new risks to which we are exposed and over which we have little personal control. So, this was about the history on how the food laws have come into existence. Let us now get on the Food Safety and Standards Act 2006 rules and regulations. The Food Safety and Standards Act received the assent of the President on 23rd August 2006 and came into effect on 5th August 2011. All the provisions of the Act have come into force except one section which deals with genetically modified foods, organic food, functional foods, proprietary foods, etc. The Act officially repeals regulatory framework established by previously existing 8 food laws. The 8 food laws which have come into the umbrella of FSSAI are Prevention of Food Adulteration Act 1954, Fruit Products Order 1955, Meat Food Products Order 1973, Vegetable Oil Products Order 1998, Edible Oils Packaging Order 1988, Solvent Extracted Oil, De-oiled Meal and Edible Flour Order 1967, Milk and Milk Products Order 1992, Essential Commodities Act 1955. All these 8 laws were consolidated into Food Safety and Standards Rules and Regulations 2011 under a single regulator, that is the Food Safety Standards Authority of India. Let us just learn about what this act is all about. The main objective of the act is to consolidate the laws relating to food and to establish the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India for laying down science-based standards for articles of food and to regulate their manufacture, storage, distribution, sale and import to ensure availability of safe, wholesome food for human consumption and for matters connected therewith. The Act puts in place a unified structure for all food safety related matters in form of FSSAI at the center and commissioners of food safety at the state level. The law is significant in ensuring quality food to consumer. It also protects consumer interest by prohibiting misleading advertisement and penalizing adulteration. In other words, the Act seeks to enhance quality of food related information to consumers and also by setting standards which, when effectively enforced by commissioners in the state, would result in increased consumer welfare. The Act is applicable to anyone who handles food processes, manufacturers, sales, services, stores, distribution, transportation or import of food or any food related products. The Act consists of 101 sections under 12 chapters and 2 schedules. General provisions with regard to articles of food are covered under the FSS Act 2006. In this, we will see about any article of food which should not contain any food additive or processing aid unless it is in accordance with the provisions of the Act. And food additive, it means any substance not normally consumed as a food by itself or used as a typical ingredient of the food, whether or not it has have nutritive value. Processing aid means any substance or material not including apparatus or utensils and not consumed as a food ingredient by itself, used in the processing of raw materials, foods or its ingredients to fulfill a certain technological purpose during treatment or processing and which may result in non-intentional but unavoidable presence of residues or derivatives in the final product. It also says that no article of food should contain any contaminant, naturally occurring toxic substances or toxins or hormones or heavy metals in excess of such quantities as may be specified by the Food Safety and Standards Regulation 2011. It also says that no article of food should contain insecticides or pesticide residues, veterinary drug residues, antibiotic residues, solvent residues, pharmacological active substances and microbiological counts in excess of tolerance limit as may be specified in the regulations. It also says that no insecticide should be used directly on article of food except fumigants which are registered and approved under the Insecticides Act 1968. It also says that no person should manufacture, distribute, sell or expose for sale or dispatch or deliver to any agent or broker for the purpose of sale any packaged food products which are not marked or labeled in the manner as specified by the Act. The Food Safety and Standards Regulation 2012 also says that every food business operator shall ensure that labeling and presentation of food, including their shape, appearance and packaging, and the packaging materials used should be in the manner in which they are arranged and the setting in which they are displayed. No advertisement should be made of any food which is misleading or deceiving or contravenes the process of this Act. There are some provisions which are said in the Act which relates to import of foods also. It says that no person should import into India any unsafe or misbranded or substandard food or food containing extraneous matter. Any article of food for the import of which a license is required under any act or rules or regulations except in accordance with conditions of the license and any article of food in contravention of any other provision of this act or any rule or regulation made thereunder or the act. There are some provisions relating to import of food also. No person should import into India any unsafe or misbranded or substandard food or foods containing extraneous matter. There are some special responsibilities as to food safety. No food business operator should employ any person who is suffering from infectious, contagious, or any kind of disease. No food business operator should sell or offer for sale any article of food to any vendor unless he also gives a guarantee in writing about the nature and quality of such article to the vendor. It also says that any food which is unsafe or a part of a batch, lot, or consignment of the food of the same class or description should be presumed that all the food in that batch, lot, or consignment should be considered unsafe. It says that general hygiene and sanitary practices should be followed by the food business operators and covered under the Schedule 4 of the licensing regulations. Let us now look at liability of the manufacturers, packers, wholesalers, distributors, and sellers. The wholesaler or distributor will be liable under this Act for any article of food which is supplied after the date of its expiry. It shouldn't be stored or supplied in violation of the safety instructions of the manufacturer. Unsafe or misbranded, unidentifiable of manufacturer from whom the article of the food have been received. The seller will be liable for any article of food which is sold after the date of its expiry, handled or kept in unhygienic conditions. There are some compliances also which come under the FSS Act. The first one is registration or licensing of food vendors. All the food vendors that have been contracted by the company need to be registered or licensed under the new FSS Act. Any vendor that operates only in one state needs to get registered with the FDA of the respective state. And for vendors who operate in more than one state, need to register with the Central Food Safety Authority. The second compliance to be followed is registration or licensing of a corporate canteen or a cafeteria if being run. Under this, it says that if any food items are being cooked, manufactured in the corporate canteen should be registered and licensing of the corporate canteens also should be done. The third compliance is adoption of food safety management system plan by the vendor. Under the Act, it is mandatory that for every food manufacturer to prepare a food safety management system plan. This plan, if prepared, will ensure the quality of monitoring of the food produced across the entire food manufacturing process. And this plan should be reviewed annually and its implementation needs to be monitored. Then the next compliance to be followed is to use potable water for cooking. All the food manufacturing bodies and food serving canteens need to get the water from their water source tested for potability. This would ensure that the water being used for cooking is drinkable and is safe for human consumption. The next compliance is for documentation of food quality monitoring initiatives. Any vendor should undergo a regular audit, and this regular audit reports can be done by an internal auditor, and it can be done as a monthly or a quarterly audit report by a food safety or hygiene auditor coupled with monthly, quarterly food. Water and hygiene swab testing reports and documentation of the steps taken for rectification of errors in case of any non-compliance to the standards found would complete the documentation required for safeguard against the rough sides of the law. Then apart from that, there are some food safety standard regulations given in 2011. The first one are food safety and standards for licensing and registration of food businesses. This details the licensing and registration procedure. Generally, the application for registration should be in Form A for petty food business operators, and the application for registration should be in Form B for food business operator. The Central Licensing Authority is licensing authority for food business which falls under Schedule 1 of this regulation. Then there are some food safety and standard regulations for packaging and labeling. no person should manufacture, distribute, sell or expose for sale or dispatch or deliver to any agent or broker for the purpose of sale any packaged food products which are not marked and labeled as per the regulations. Then we have the food safety and standards for food product standards and food additives. This act says that no article of food should contain any food additive or processing aid except in accordance with the regulations. Later, we have food safety and standards for prohibition and restriction on sales regulation. This regulation provides for prohibition of sale of certain admixtures, restriction on use of certain ingredients, prohibition and restriction on sale of certain products, and restrictions related to conditions for sale. Then we have the food safety and standards for contaminants, toxins, and residues. This says that no article of food should contain any contaminant, naturally occurring toxic substance or toxins or hormone or heavy metals in excess of such quantities as may be specified in the regulations. Then we have the food safety and standards for laboratory and sampling analysis. This regulation provides for recognition and accreditation of laboratories, research institutions and referral food laboratory, notified laboratories for import, procedure for sampling, etc. Apart from these regulations which come under the Food Safety and Standards Act 2006 and 2011, we also need to learn about other laws which are applicable to hygiene, safety and implementation. Now, these laws will not be directly relevant to the food consumption or food manufacturing procedures, but they are very, very important to be understood as a part of the laws which are applicable on hygiene, safety and implementation with respect to foods. First one is legal metrology laws, which deals with the weights, units of weighment and measurement, methods of weighment and measurement, weighing and measuring instruments, and in relation to mandatory technical and legal requirements which have an objective of ensuring public guarantee from the point of view of security and accuracy of weighments and measurements. Then we have the environmental laws, which are very complex and interlocking bodies of statutes, common laws, treaties, conventions, regulations and policies which very broadly operate to regulate the interaction of humanity and the rest of biophysical or natural environment. Now, let us go to the food standards. We have Bureau of Indian Standards, which is the national standards body of India working under the aegis of Ministry of Consumer Affairs, Food and Public Distribution, Government of India. It is established by the Bureau of Indian Standards Act 1986, which came into effect on 23rd December 1986. The organization was formerly called as ISI, Indian Standards Institution. One of the major functions of the Bureau is formulation, recognition, and promotion of Indian standards. Product certifications are to be obtained voluntarily from the Bureau of Indian Standards. So, the certificates are mandatory to be obtained from the Bureau of Indian Standards. Then, we have the International Organization for Standardization. It is also called as ISO. ISO has published ISO 22000 Food Safety Management Systems requirements for any organization in the food chain with a view to provide framework for internationally harmonized requirements for systematically managing safety in food supply chains. Consequent to the publication of ISO 22000, BIS has adapted this ISO 22000. And this standard integrates the principles of HACCP. HACCP means Hazard Analysis Critical Control Point. So, this standard integrates the principles of HACCP and Codex Alimentarius Commission and combines the HACCP plan with prerequisite programs and is fully compatible with the quality management systems as per ISO 9001. BIS has launched Food Safety Management Systems Certification that is ISO 22000 scheme, which envisages grant of FSMS certifications license to organizations according to ISO 22000. We have another law, that is AgMark. The word AgMark is derived from agricultural marketing. The AgMark standard was set up by Directorate of Marketing and Inspection, Ministry of Agriculture, Government of India, by introducing an Agricultural Produce Act in 1937. The word AgMark seal ensures about the quality and purity of food products. The quality of the food product is determined with reference to size, variety, weight, color, moisture, fat content, and other factors which are taken into account. It also covers quality assurances of unprocessed, semi-processed, and processed agricultural commodities. AgMark lays down the specifications for various adulteration-prone commodities like butter, ghee, vegetable oils, ground spices, honey, wheat, etc. AgMark also covers pulses, cereals, makhana, vegetable oils, fruits and vegetables, roasted Bengal gram, vermicelli, macaroni and spaghetti. Blended edible oils and fat spread are compulsorily required to get certification under AgMark. Products available under AgMark are pulses, wheat products, vegetable oils, ground spices, whole spices, milk products, honey, compounded asafoetida, rice, tapioca, sago, seedless tamarind and gram flour. Grading of these commodities is voluntary. On the other hand, grading of commodities like tobacco, walnut, spices, basmati rice, essential oils, onion, potatoes are meant for export is compulsory under AgMark. So, after BIS and AgMark, we will see about Codex. Codex Alimentarius Commission is an international body constituted by Food and Agricultural Organization and World Health Organization of United Nations with an objective to protect health of consumers and to ensure fair practices in the food trade. Codex prescribes international standards for safety and quality of food as well as codes of good manufacturing practices, guidelines to protect health of consumers. Codex standards usually relate to product characteristics and may deal with all government regulated characteristics which are appropriate to commodity or only one characteristic. Maximum residue limits for residues of pesticides or veterinary drugs in foods are examples of standards dealing with only one characteristics. There are Codex General Standards for food additives and contaminants and toxins in foods that contain both general and commodity specific provisions. Then we have the next standard, that is HACCP, Hazard Analysis Critical Control Point, which is a process control system designed to identify and prevent microbial and other hazards in food production. It includes steps designed to prevent problems before they occur and to correct deviations as soon as they are detected. Such preventive control system with documentation and verification are widely recognized by scientific authorities and international organizations as the most effective approach available for producing safe food. HACCP involves a systems approach to identification of hazard assessment of chances of occurrence of hazards during each phase, raw material procurement, manufacturing, distribution, usage of food products and in defining measures for hazard control. In doing so, the many drawbacks prevalent in the inspection approaches are provided and HACCP overcomes shortcomings of reliance only on microbial testing. HACCP also enables the producers, processors, distributors, exporters, etc. of food products to utilize technical resources efficiently and in a cost-effective manner in assuring food safety. Food inspection, too, would be more systematic and therefore hassle-free. It would no doubt involve deployment of some additional finances initially, but this would be more than compensated in the long run through consistency and better quality and hence better prices and returns. Then lastly, we have ISO 9000. Implementation of the ISO standards enables export enterprises in developing countries to offer products or services that meet well-defined needs, satisfy consumer expectations, comply with applicable standards and specifications, as well as conform to requirements in regard to health and safety, protection of environment, and conservation of energy and materials. All these at lower cost and higher levels of efficiency. Application of ISO 9000 in fruit and vegetable processing industry and ISO 9000 series of standards are generic standards and are applicable equally both to manufacturing as well as service industries. Under individual circumstances, these need to be tailored to meet the requirements specific to each industry. The fruit and vegetable processing industry has its own special features such as variable quality of raw material due to its agricultural origin, limited shelf life of both raw materials and final product, importance of packing and storaging to maintain the product safe for human consumption, need to maintain proper hygienic conditions during manufacture, storage and distribution, as well as these products are often liable to microbial contamination and toxin development. In addition, food additives are added to enhance appeal and shelf life, and if these are not judiciously controlled, they may prove to be harmful. These special features need to be given due consideration while orienting ISO 9000 to any kind of food industry. Then there are some kinds of regulatory authorities which will be monitoring the activities of Food Safety and Standards Act, that is the Ministry of Food Processing Industries. We also have some organizations related to the industry which also keep on monitoring these food laws. Some of them are National Institute of Food Technology, Entrepreneurship and Management, it is called as NIFTEM. Then Indian Institute of Crop Processing Technology, that is IICPT, Indian Grape Processing Board, and National Meat and Poultry Processing Board, NMPPB, and APEDA, that is Agricultural and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority. These are some of the organizations, and some more are Marine Products Export Development Authority, that is MPEDA, which keep on helping and monitoring the food laws and safety standards for India. People from these institutions also participate in legalizing a framework for the food safety laws in India. To summarize and conclude the entire topic, we should know that food safety is an important social and health priority for any country. Apart from health, food safety is vital for economic growth and progress as well. In India, the food processing industry holds tremendous opportunity. It has high employment potential, can boost exports of agro products out of the country, and also provide better returns to farmers for their produce. However, this is possible only if food safety laws and standards are effectively enforced in the country. Despite having a legal framework in place, India still struggles with enforcing food safety norms and standards effectively. Therefore, it is very important to go forward with a collaborative effort between center, states, and the private sector to address the challenge of food safety in the country by generating new knowledge that would help in continuously updating and upgrading the food safety standards which are compatible with international organizations, and by carrying out evidence-based studies for improving or building policies. Thank you.